sound of the drums and the sound of the shakeray. That means it's time for the Griot Storytelling Circle. Welcome to the circle. My name is Sister Martha, and I'm your Griot, which means your storyteller. And today we're giving thanks. We're giving thanks for family, and we're giving thanks for our first family, President Obama, First Lady Michelle, and their daughters, Malia and Sasha, and even Mrs. Obama's mother, Mrs. Robinson. This is a time when we remember how important family is and how much family strengthens us. One writer shared a salute to his mother, and his name is Walter Dean Myers. We recently lost Walter Dean Myers, but he left us a bounty of writings, and one of them is this book of poetry called Angel to Angel, a salute to mothers. And using old-time photographs, Walter Dean Myers created poems to salute mothers and their children. And one of them talks about trees. And this poem says, I am a tree. Here we go. I am a tree, strong-limbed and deeply rooted. My fruit is bittersweet. I am your mother. You are a tree, a sapling by the river, with buds streaming for the shining sun. You are my child. Together, we are a forest against the wind. And that poem is Trees by Walter Dean Myers. And then one of my most favorite poems in this collection is a poem called Mother. Memories of you lie like autumn leaves in the field that is my life. I see the missing parts as one senses sound in an empty stadium. What remains? A brown doily you loved, a brittle iris pressed into an antique Bible. Echo your tenderness. Leaves fall and fade, and as I walk through them, taller than you ever thought I'd be, what is left is the comforting rustle of love. And that's Mother by Walter Dean Myers in this collection called Angel to Angel, A Mother's Gift of Love. Now, mothers and fathers and children, aunts and uncles and grandmothers, all come together to make a family. Whether it's a single mother and a child, or a single father and a child, whether it's a husband and wife, a family is the thing that gives us comfort. And there's an older book that tells about a family situation about this time of year that brought a lot of comfort. Bob Teague was a reporter, a journalist, a TV anchor back in the 60s. And he wrote a book of letters to his son during the first year that his son was born. And the book is called Letters to a Black Boy. And in those letters, Bob Teague tries to tell his son about some of the things that he's going to face. Because you know, during the 60s, there were a lot of upheaval and uprisings. It was the year that Dr. King died. And so he told his son about some of the things he would need to face and be prepared for. But he also shared the love that his family had. And so Bob Teague told his son about one Thanksgiving. It was a Thanksgiving when his aunt called all of her nieces and nephews together. Now, she was an aunt who had never married. Aunt Letty, though, had a child. Her child was Bob, because Bob's mother died when she gave birth to him. And not thinking about anything else in her life, Aunt Letty left Detroit and came to Milwaukee to take care of Bob and his father. And she raised him well. She told him the things that he needed to do. She was his teacher before he even knew what going to school was like. And she would make him speak properly and do his homework and do all those things that would make him a strong man. Well, when Bob went to college, he was a sophomore in college when Aunt Letty had gone back to Detroit and gotten her master's degree and was teaching. And now she was calling her grown-up son to come back for Thanksgiving along with his father and his other aunts and uncles. Now she said to her nephews and nieces, don't bring your children with you. This is an adult affair. So Bob felt pretty good that he was going to be at the Thanksgiving dinner and be considered an adult. But of course, his aunt wanted to see him because he was her special child. And as they got together, they realized that it had been years since they had all gathered together like that. It was a first time for them as adults, and with their children out of the picture, they could share some of those memories that they had forgotten about. Those memories about Grandpa and the things that he would do to keep them in line. And every story they told ended up with, and Grandpa gave me the whooping of my life that day. Yes, they remembered how their grandmother would make them go and choose their switch for their whipping. But they all grew up to be good family people who took care of their families and raised their children. And Aunt Letty, she laid out a big Thanksgiving dinner with all the fixings. And when they had finished eating, she finally told them why she had brought them all together. Now, young people, because they were young to her, even though they were older adults, I know that you know how important family is, and I know that sometimes you forget about how much we need to get together and work together. Well, I called you together because I got a letter from your nephew, my great nephew, Roger, saying he wanted to go to college so that he could be an airplane pilot. And I think that he should. You know, there's only one thing stopping him. He doesn't have the money to go to college. Now, I'm sure that none of you have the money to send him to college either. But I do know that all of us have the money to send him to college. And if we all work together, we can do it. And so from that day, they set up a family fund so that all of their children could go to college. And all of them contributed to the fund, and Roger went on to college. And Bob, who was already in college, he was proud of his family, the proudest he had ever been, to see them working together and making life better for their children. And it all happened on that Thanksgiving that Aunt Letty called the family together. Well, we're thankful that it doesn't take a Thanksgiving for us to get together. We can get together anytime we like, and so that's what we should do. We should get together and share memories and remember those good times. And when we have those memories and when we share, that gives us the motivation, the energy to go on and do great things. One of the things that we remember is when our first family got inaugurated and went into the White House. Oh, it was a wonderful day. I remember it well because I went to the inauguration. No, I didn't have one of those special tickets that got you into the close-up seats, the celebrity seats. But I did get up early, just like lots of people, to come see if I could squeeze in and find a place to watch the inauguration live. Or I could have stayed in my bed and watched it on the TV, but I wanted to be there. And this is the reason why. It was an exciting day. There were lots of people gathered around, and they brought lots of things to help them remember that special day. Some people had things with President Obama's picture on it, like this kente cloth that was made in Ghana, West Africa. And some people just had a button that they would put on, like this button that says Living the Dream. It has a picture of Dr. King and President Obama on it. And then other people were getting souvenirs, like this mug with President Obama on it. It says President of the United States, Barack Obama, number 44. And so the night before the inauguration, my cousins and my best girlfriends and my sister and my niece, we all gathered at my cousin's house in Silver Spring to get ready to get up at the crack of dawn so we could be at the inauguration. Oh, we had fun. It was just like a sleepover. But we went to bed early because the next morning we were going to get up at 4 a.m. And that's what we did. And we got up and got ready. By 5 o'clock, we were headed to the metro. We didn't know what to expect. There didn't seem to be too many people at that Silver Spring metro, but we got a metro access card that had President Obama's picture on it. And wouldn't you know it? We didn't even have to use it. There were lots of metro workers and they were saying, come on through, come on through. And then we saw the crowds. As we got on the metro, the train filled up and up and up until we were squeezed in. And we got off just at the place they told us to get off at. And when we got off, what did we see? Walls and walls and walls of people. People trying to decide which way was the best way to get to see the inauguration. And all of the streets of Washington, D.C. were deserted. No cars were moving because the streets were filled with people going this way and going that way, going in a car tunnel to get to the other side. And as we followed the crowd, we were swept along with the crowd as we tried to look around to see. We found that even though we were there 7 o'clock in the morning, there was already a crowd of people. They say some people had slept out overnight. And so we were way back from the stage, almost near the Washington Monument. But there were big Jumbotron TV monitors that we could see. And as we waited for the inauguration to start, they played a video of a celebration that was held the day before with lots of stars who were singing songs and celebrating this first African American president. And then it was time. And as the Jumbotron focused on the inauguration on the Capitol steps, we were so excited to see President Obama, Mrs. Obama, Malia, and Sasha come down those steps and take their place. And wouldn't you know it, there was singing and prayer, and everyone was talking about Aretha Franklin singing in her Sunday hat. It was a hat that now is in the National African American Museum. And they began to get ready for the swearing in. The Chief Justice of the Supreme Court stood with the Bible in his hand, and President Obama came and stood before him, and Michelle Obama stood next to him as he raised the right hand, put his hand on the Bible, and he swore to carry out the Constitution and to be the president of the United States of America. Oh, what a cheer went up after he finished being sworn in. And there were people with tears, and there were people who said, thank you, thank you. I live to see this day. Well, after it was over, there was still another challenge to get back home with all those people. Of course, there was also a lot of people who were coming down just for the parade, because now President and Mrs. Obama would walk down Pennsylvania Avenue. We weren't going to be able to go to that, but the streets were blocked off in such a way that it took us hours to get back to the metro and to get back home. What a day. What a day to remember. And you can remember it by looking at this book called Our Enduring Spirit. And this is done by an artist who has illustrated some of the inauguration words, some of the inauguration speech of President Obama. And in it, you will see the challenges that President Obama knew that we would face. And as we remember those 8 years of President Obama serving as our president, we know that in spite of all that he tried to do, the best thing that he did was to bring us together as a family. He and First Lady Michelle Obama would hold cultural events. They brought people into the White House who never thought they would be invited there. And they did things that brought just everyday people into the White House. Mrs. Obama had a garden, and school children would come and dig and plant in the garden in the White House. And most of all, we enjoyed watching the Facebook and the other social media things that came from the White House, like the 107-year-old lady who got to meet President and Mrs. Obama, and she was so excited that she was dancing. Well, we can find out more about Mrs. Obama through this book, Michelle. And in it, we can see just how she grew up and how she became the First Lady of the United States. Growing up on the west side, on the south side of Chicago, she was an excellent student. And she went to Harvard and to Princeton, and she was a lawyer. But most of all, she got to meet another lawyer, Barack Obama. And after they got to know each other, they fell in love and were married. And it was thanks to them that we could see two young ladies grow up in the White House too. Sasha and Malia Obama gave us a glimpse of what life was like to live in the White House, even with things like sending out a family picture. When you think about all the things that we have enjoyed with the Obamas over the years, sometimes you think about music. And we know, even though he says he's not a singer, there are a couple of songs that remind us of President Obama. Well, of course, the first thing people are going to say is the Al Green song. And one day, before he gave a speech, he was led to start sharing, let's stay together. But of course, we also remember the tragedies that President Obama helped to ease the pain of some of the people who went through some tragedies, like the shooting in North Carolina at a church. And he gave this eulogy at the funeral. And at the end of the eulogy, he was led to sing a song that all of us can relate to. And he said, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." And the whole congregation, all of those people in the church, stood up and joined him in singing that song that reminds us of tragedies will come in our life, but we still have grace. We still have hope for the future. Well, I hope that as you gather around your Thanksgiving tables, you'll share your memories of our first family, as this is the last month that they will be our first family. And so we need to pass it on, share those stories. Now, some of you, hopefully many of you, have written letters to the Obamas. And there is a book of letters that were written to Michelle Obama when she became First Lady. And it's called Go Tell Michelle. And these are a collection of letters that women wrote to Michelle to congratulate her as well as to give her advice. And one letter says, "Thank you, First Lady Michelle, for epitomizing such a tall order. Honor thy father and thy mother. Thank you for sharing precious memories that you paint of a loving and supportive dad." Because Michelle Obama's father died before she was before she became First Lady. "Thank you for including your dear mother inside the White House. Family makes a real home glad. Thanks to your chosen path, precious girls like yours and my two granddaughters and females worldwide are poised to take uncharted leaps. For we all are daughters of Abraham, to whom much is promised. Watch future generations reap." And this was a letter from Geraldine Drake Hawkins. And she actually lives in our county. She is from Bowie in Prince George's County. So, if you're so led, not only remember our first family and give thanks for our first family, but send them a note. Send them your thoughts and share with them so that they can know how much they're appreciated. Well, for many of us, the way we got to know President Obama the first time was through his very own book, and it's called Dreams from My Father. And he wrote this before he became senator and before he became president, and it was a, what does he call it? A story of race and inheritance. So he says, it's not really an autobiography, it's not really a memoir, but it's how I kind of dealt with my life up to that point in time and the things that I went through. We know that President Obama's mother was a white American and his father was an African, and so they did not stay together during his childhood. He only got to see his father maybe twice in his life. And during those times, he had to figure out, what does all this mean? And how do I keep that as a part of me? How do I interpret that? Well, Dreams from My Father shares his journey from childhood to going to Harvard Law School and becoming the president of the Harvard Review, and then to top it off, realizing that he needed to find out about his African heritage. And so we see his trip to Kenya, where he meets that extended family that he had never had a chance to meet. And he comes to grips with his American and his African heritage. Now, one of the things that is shared in the story is his wedding to Michelle. And he got married in Hawaii, where he's from. He is he was a citizen of Hawaii and when he grew up. And so the wedding was held there. And he talks about his grandparents and how they reacted differently to Michelle. His grandfather said, "Oh, Barack, she's a real looker." But his grandmother said, "Barack, she's wonderful, such a sensible young lady." And Barack knew that these blessings from his grandparents meant that he had chosen a good wife. And so the wedding was held. Some of his African family members were able to come, and one of his favorite newly found brothers was there. His name was Abones. And he said to him, "I guess this is what family is all about." And they had a tradition that many of us had. They shared the tradition of having a drink together. But before they took that drink, they poured a little on the floor to say, in memory of those who can't, who are no longer here with us. And this is a tradition that many people do, and some people call it a libation, to do memories of those people who have gone on. Well, as you gather at your Thanksgiving table, and as you gather at other family gatherings, remember those people who are no longer with us. Remember those young people who need our help finding their way in life. And then remember, as my grandmother said to me, and as you'll find in the Bible, to your own self, be true. And this is what we all have to do as we go on to be a family and to strengthen each other and comfort each other, but being the best person that we can be. Thank you for joining us today for The Circle, and we hope to see you again soon when it will be time again for The Griot's Storytelling Circle. Thank you.